I'm particularly pleased of the subject because we combine something practical, which is FFR, with something that is new, that is a concept that started in our hospital, IFR, that I will try to clarify to you all. First of all, we will speak quite a lot about guidelines in this seminar, and as you know, class 1A is the maximum that you can give in terms of recommendation to a technique or to a treatment or to a drug, means evidence and or general agreement that a given treatment or procedure is beneficial, useful, and effective, and A means that you have multiple trials to support it. So FFR-guided PCI is recommended in the most recent 2010 myocardial revascularization guidelines for detection of ischemia-related lesion when objective evidence of vessel-related ischemia is not available. And in fact, this is quite a frequent phenomenon. If you exclude the patient with acute coronary syndrome, you can see that both in Europe and the United States, around 70-75% of patients coming to your cath lab do not have a firm evidence of ischemia. So, hence the importance of a technique like this if you want to avoid what is called oculostenotic reflex. You see a narrowing, you have a patient with some symptom that maybe you don't know clinically well enough, and you jump to the conclusion that the stent will make the situation better. But this conclusion is potentially thrown with the sense that the community feels that you are not doing this for the well-being of the patient, but for your own benefit or the benefit of your own hospital. And appropriateness in the United States first, but now spread into Europe and probably to this area of the world as well, is now something that we need to be very aware. I think this is probably behind the fact that in the United Kingdom, as in the rest of the world, this technique has shown an exponential growth. Last year, we had around 15,000 FFR procedures. Of course, not all of them are used during PCI, and some of them you exclude the need of PCI, but just to give an idea, this is around 16% of all the angioplasties performed in this country, and almost 90% of the units doing angiography and angioplasty have a system to measure pressure distal to a stenosis. These systems have become easier and easier to use. This is probably the most recent, a pressure wires that communicates with Bluetooth, like your mobiles, with central unit that displays both the intracoronary pressure and the pressure recorded via the guiding catheter, or the same signal can be sent to your cath lab recording system. So definitely the technique has made it easier, and these devices are more reliable. What is somehow adding to the complexity is the fact that to measure this index, you need to induce maximal vasodilatation. This is normally achieved with the use of adenosine, which has some potential contraindications in patients with chronic bronchoconstrictive disease, which is unpleasant for the patient when given systemically, giving some subjective evidence of chest discomfort, which requires a large venous line, not always available, especially when we do a radial approach. We do not normally catheterize also a large vein. You can potentially give it also intracoronary, but this is somewhat less reliable. Tendentially, the patient should be not caffeinated. I guess in this country, probably like in mine, you have to police your patients and put two nurses for 24 hours before the cath to make sure they don't drink coffee or tea or Coca-Cola. If you use adenosine under the circumstances that are different, the result is much less predictable. So adenosine is an issue, not only the cost, not being the least. So can we have an adenosine-free index that is equally valid? Well, the group at Imperial College has developed the concept of instantaneous wave-free ratio, IFR, trying to take advantage of the fact that in diastole you have a wave-free period when resistance is constant and minimal. That is the reason why you use adenosine. So you need to have two hypotheses fulfilled to use this index instead of FFR. The first is that the resistance that you measure at rest during this diastolic wave-free period is similar to the mean resistance that you measure during the entire cardiac cycle during hyperemia. And the second hypothesis is that the ratio between the distal pressure and the arterial pressure during this period is, that is achieved at rest again without adenosine, is similar to the classical adenosine-induced FFR. So we studied in a fairly large team and a large group of patients this concept, and we have to acknowledge a very young researcher from our group, Dr. Justin Davis, who has been behind all the theoretical development while many of us have tested this concept. We had two phases in the ADVICE trial, which has been reported at TCT this year and published in the GCC last year. The first is a validation that measuring with a flow wire flow velocity intracoronary, you have a resistance which is similar in the resting period of the wave-free diastole to the resistance that you have as a mean after adenosine, and this was achieved, as you can see, showing that hyperemic mean resistance is equal to resting wave-free resistance and around half of the resting mean resistance. The second is a more simple comparison in a fairly large number of patients, including studies in all vessel and a majority of stable patients, but including patients with various risk factors and poor left ventricular ejection fraction, correlating IFR and FFR, which, as you can see, have an excellent correlation with a regression coefficient close to the unity. If you consider the diagnostic efficiency of this index, you see that the predictive value is positive 91%, negative 85%. If you consider the variability of FFR, which is around 3 to 5% in repeated measurement, you have an even greater overlapping of the two indices. So in a way, we have demonstrated that the two indices measure the same thing, and I hope that what I'm going to say from now on about FFR in the future will be confirmed also to be achievable with this new index. These are 7 views. I don't think you do all these views for your routine coronary angiogram of the left coronary artery, but occasionally, especially in women, you have very complex and tortuous anatomy where it's very difficult to visualize well the lesion. So is this lesion in the mid LAD truly significant? Well, you can say that is maybe a 70% reduction if you compare with this part of the artery, but more often you will compare with a neighboring segment and say is a 50%. In some views, you almost don't see it. Making another 7 more will not clarify the issue. What clarifies the issue is a simple physiological measure, inserting a pressure wire distal and, in this case, measuring FFR after adenosine, having a measurement which is below the threshold of 0.8, which is modernly used as the index to decide when you revascularize. So in this particular case, we went for revascularization and we use an imaging technique to be guided to know the size of the balloons to use and to know which type of lesions, as you can see with calcific components, very eccentric, which explains the difficulty to see this lesion well in multiple views, with an area of 3.72 square millimeter, much smaller than proximal and distal, but in absolute term still somewhat equivocal. Classically, when you use an imaging technique like intravascular ultrasound, you use 4.0 as an index for assessment of a severe lesion, but this correlates very poorly with FFR. Around 68% of lesions that are smaller than 4 square millimeter have a negative FFR. If you go to 3 square millimeter, you reduce this percentage, but the issue is obviously related to the vessel size. If you have a very small vessel, this threshold goes down to 2.5 square millimeter, and only in very large vessel approaches the 4 millimeter that are traditionally used, 3.7 square millimeter. Similar data has been repeated in a larger study by our Korean colleagues. So very important FFR before intervention to decide whether to intervene or not, much better than imaging technique to decide the functional importance of a lesion, but not as good as imaging technique for guidance of your intervention. Here you have an FFR that is perfect. One, you have an angiographically acceptable lesion, but if you look from inside, you do have struts of the stent you have implanted, 28 millimeter with a 3-0 balloon post-expanded at high pressure, that are still not opposed proximally, and we are speaking of a gross malapposition. You have areas of incomplete expansion and struts across the origin of the side branch. You have an expansion and a very elliptical lumen shape in the area of most severe stenosis before treatment. In the past, people have claimed that FFR can be a good index to measure the result of your intervention. In particular, after bare metal stents, the group of Eindhoven said that above 0.91, you have very low risk of new events, and in particular target lesion revascularization at follow-up, while for lower measurements, you do have percentages of 20 or above. However, this is not cannot be improved by your intervention. This is simply a measurement of what is the vessel you are dealing with. As has been shown by the colleagues in Alst, if the vessel is truly normal, you always have an FFR that will normalize above 92, but if the vessel has, in the absence of a critical discrete lesion greater than 50% diffuse disease, you may have the surprise that after having placed your stent and having perfectly expanded it, still you do have a pathologic FFR, and your worse prognosis, your worse follow-up is related to diffuse disease, which is something that you can deal with, but with covering the entire segment with stents. Coming back to our case, what we have done is to use an appropriately sized balloon based on OCT to expand the proximal vessel, and here it is, to use kissing balloon to avoid the jailing of the side branch beyond the struts, to use truly high pressure with an appropriately sized balloon to increase the area of the vessel at the most severe site where the calcified lesion was present. Let me show another intriguing example. This is a gentleman who had two 3-0 millimeter long Cypher stents implanted in the LAD and was sent to me because he had almost immediate recurrence of symptoms that persisted for several months. And when this CT was done, this was interpreted as a severe restenosis, this lack of opacification in the mid segment, where, as you can see, there is obvious overlap plus calcification that, in my view, makes impossible the interpretation. What I take home in terms of interpretation of this image is that the two stents are clearly protruding into the left main and covering the origin of the cirque, and apparently there is a lack of apposition proximally. So these are the angiographic images, and I confess, I think many, many people will just accept this as a mild distal narrowing of the left main and dismiss this as a non-atypical angina not requiring any treatment. I hope you know now what to do. Stick a pressure wire that takes 5 minutes and solve your problem. You measure an FFR of 0.79, and then you can try to understand how, with an imaging technique, why this FFR is impaired with an imaging technique, showing that at this level you do have an area which is less than 6 square millimeters, which is the index normally used to indicate a severe left main stenosis, much smaller than the size of the neighboring and normal looking proximal left main, and much smaller also of the LED downstream. So just expansion at high pressure, another short stent, opening in the direction of the cirque, better with imaging guidance. Look what we were doing with, if we had not checked the position of our wire recrossing into the cirque. We were inserting our second wire below the stent strut, so we were going to make a mess of the new stent we had implanted. These are mistakes that can be avoided if you judiciously use together functional and imaging methods for lesion assessment and guidance of your intervention. And this is the final result achieved with good stent expansion and opening towards the left circumflex. Let's come back to FFR and to the results in the most recent of the studies with this technique in multivessel disease, a studies that have reported recently results at 2 years involving 20 centers, more than 1,000 patients, with a simple randomization towards treating whatever looks angiographically critical or treating only what, after having measured with FFR all the lesion, has an FFR of less than 0.8. In one group, 2.7 stents were implanted. In the second group, 1.9 stents were implanted, so much fewer lesions had to be treated. So it's true in these circumstances, as in many others in life, that sometimes more is less. So you implant more stents, you treat more lesions, but you don't get a better result, you get a worse result in terms of more deaths, MI and repeat revascularization, 4.5% more in the angio-guided group, and most of it is related to true worsening of the hard endpoint of death and MI. If you look in the patients where you didn't treat lesions because the FFR was more than 0.8 at 2 years, you can see that the majority of events were either periprocedural or related to areas of the vessel that were near normal. And only one out of all the patients, all the 513 lesions that were deferred, they were not done based on FFR, had an event, 0.2% at 2 years. So definitely this explains the results. Let me finish by saying that FFR also obviously technically much more applicable in the context of stable syndromes can also offer advantages when used in ACS or even in primary angioplasty to decide whether future treatment will be needed in vessels which appear to be having stenosis greater than 50%. So the result of your FFR at the time of the acute myocardial infarction is similar after 1 month, telling you that you can either, for the simplest lesion, perform at the time of primary angioplasty multivessel treatment, not what I recommend in general, however, or knowing at least at the time of the primary angioplasty whether the lesion that you will treat subsequently can only require medical treatment or will do better if a stent is used or surgery is used. So my conclusion is that it makes sense to treat only lesion that cause ischemia, and FFR, and possibly in the future IFFR helps in that. I didn't discuss the deferring single vessel disease, but this, like FAME, shows improvement of results clinically if you use FFR together with your good clinical judgment and angiographic judgment to guide treatment. ACC and ESC guidelines strongly recommend the use of this technique for intermediate lesion assessment. But to conclude my talk, it's an easy and practical technique. I mean, patients nowadays don't just accept our authority. Patients in this country and, in the country where I come from, Italy, like traveling, like going asking second opinion. I know patients from this country going around the world. So if you want to be sure that when they go to Mayo Clinic, to Cleveland Clinic, or London, or Berlin, or Paris, they don't find somebody who says, well, you know, the interpretation of your doctor is maybe acceptable, but see, your symptoms are still there, have a clear objective evidence that nobody can question. So use this technique. Thank you.
So, Ms. Diakoukis, what about the cost?
Well, I mean, I think that the cost of the wire itself is not certainly greater than the cost of the vast majority of the non-invasive tests we used. If you consider nuclear scan or stress echo, the time, the labor that is required, and if you have a patient in the cath lab, the fact that you have to stop your procedure, send the patient for a non-invasive test, and then potentially redo your procedure, that is an enormous additional cost in terms of bed stay. I think that's also, this device is not incredibly cheap, but pays by itself. Absolutely. FAME had also an economical cost assessment and was favorable for the group, not only because the clinical result was better, but also because, as you pointed out, you don't stent what is not needed.
In another way, did the FFR abolish or cancel our plan for both stent? And what was the percentage of that cancellation?
Well, I think, of course, it varies enormously according to what is your routine preparation of your patient. In our hospital, we do use a lot of functional non-invasive tests. So I would say most often what we do see is a difference in not treating some of the lesions in a multivessel setting. While if a patient comes to the table, most of the time already have clear-cut objective evidence of ischemia. But in hospital, not using this practice, I think that you have surprises in both directions. Some patients say 30%, 40%, you will not do it. But some lesion, especially long LAD stenosis that you don't like doing because they are very complex and they don't look so severe because everything is compromised, you will find at the end that there is a fractional flow reserve below 0.80, and these are cases that maybe are better treated with surgery than with 25 stents.
Okay, one final question from Dr. Jihadi.
Okay, I can see very obviously the value of FLR when there's an indeterminate lesion. And we use FFR in that sense. But when the lesion is obviously severe on angiography, was there any studies to show that FFR has actually added to the discrimination of the severity of lesions?
I will show in my next talk some results from the FAME trial that go in this direction, where even lesions between 70 and 90, and even above 90%, have a minute score for above 90, but moderately elevated for 70 to 90% normal FFR measurement. And the implications also for treatment will be quite clear when I will represent this data. You know, FAME was positive also because of those lesions, leaving LED lesion that looks 60, 70%, and they did better not treating those vessels. I think in part, of course, we are dealing with patients that from the moment are diagnosed, we start to aggressively use with secondary prevention. And I think this potentially makes a difference compared with the past.